being as good a man as my dad was, I'm doing the best I can. But he lived to be almost 100 and almost 101. He was, and I'll tell y'all that don't exercise, he started after college going to the YMCA 2 or 3 times a week. And he'd run and play basketball with those young guys at the YMCA. And that's part of it. So I'm not keeping up with him on that. But I see there's some people that are in pretty good shape. And I think taking care of the machine is important because it will give out. Y'all, thank you for inviting me. It's delightful to be here. Peggy sends her regards. Our new bulldog, his name is Matt, named honorably after her daddy, sends his regards. He's 9 months old. He's about 52 pounds now, and you'll have to see him on a TV ad before too long. Some folks say that's how I got elected lieutenant governor. I got a friend who lives in Camden, and he has a friend here who you see at church. He's an older gentleman. And he'd say to my friend Gene McCaskill, he'd say, Gene, I can't vote for any Republicans. He said, why is that? Since all the ones that they all lawyers, not to vote for them. So how about the Democrats? He said, not to vote for a lawyer. Election after election, he'd say to Gene, can't vote for this guy, that guy, this woman, because they're a lawyer. Well, now I was running in 2014 and had an ad on television that had the dog Boots. Y'all might remember, it's a great ad. A lot of people commented on it. Anyway, the fellow came up to Gene and said, Gene, after the election, said, Gene, I voted for your boy. He said, why'd you do that? He's a lawyer. He says, the dog did it. I'll take it anyway. Y'all, I'll try to be brief, and I'd like to try to answer your questions. I will tell you one funny story. I'm a Republican, so I went to the Republican convention in Cleveland, of course. And on the way up, my wife, Peggy, said, can you believe it? Ever in your wildest dream did you see your husband, Henry, doing a nominating speech for Donald Trump at the National Convention? Did you ever see that in your wildest dream? She said, I hate to tell you, Henry, I never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. She's from Spartanburg, she can't help it. Y'all, we're on the way up. And just coming in and looking at this hotel, it just reminds me, it's a reflection of what's happened to our state. Because way back in Revolutionary War times, this was the richest place on the continent. All the kings and queens, when they were sending the explorers over, they were looking over this new world, they were writing back to those kings and queens, explorers, saying of all the places on this coast, that the richest, the best place was what we call South Carolina, a little bit of North Carolina. And we haven't lost any of that. All those natural resources are still here. But since that time, we've been through every war, we've been through hurricanes, we've been through floods, we've been through everything. And right now, I think is we're on the cusp of being as strong as we were way back in Revolutionary War times. This was the richest place among all the colonies just at the time of the Revolutionary War. So with that, what have we done during the interim between now and then? People here, we've got strong people. They came, as you remember, the Lord's proprietors were asking people to come over. Anybody who wanted to come, it's a business venture for 8 of them. They were buddies of the king. Some over their deal was to make money. And so to do that, they had to have people. So they opened the door and wanted anybody to come. As a result, you had all kind of people. Religion wasn't an issue like it was in New England. Nothing was an issue. If you were willing to come, they would come on. And as a result, we had people, and a lot of these are still here. We're probably the most diverse state of them all, because we had people from 9 European countries coming over. We had people from 19 African cultures coming over against their will, of course, as you know. And we had, that was all based on 40 Indian nations at one time or another were in South Carolina. You just can't get any more diverse than that. So you take that kind of diverse and strength built on an opportunity to grow and thrive, and then connect that with the religious freedom that was allowed when everyone came in. You've got a culture over the years that has developed and grown and what has produced us now to be in a position, I believe, to lead the rest of the country in economic development and prosperity. We did have a lull that coincided roughly with the Civil War, or war between the states, if you prefer that, and we went into a dip then. You remember there was a lot destroyed here in South Carolina as well as others. other places, but somewhere around the 50s or the 60s, that's where we blossomed again. It reminds me a lot of this hotel. I'm old enough to remember when this place was condemned. I'm old enough to remember when it was a beautiful place before that. And then it took a dive. I remember there were bones sweeping downstairs. It had the condemnation signs up, everything. And it was talking about tearing it down. It's a good thing we didn't. Look at it now. You can't build anything like this anymore. So we've treasured those things in South Carolina, and we have an opportunity. We have a platform, as they would call it nowadays, to build this state even stronger than it has ever been before. When I say build the state, I'm not talking about buildings and things. I'm talking about people, because that's where the strength is. The strength of a country, the strength of a state, the strength of a family all comes from the people. And let me tell you this, with the opportunities I've had in recent years to visit and to discuss business opportunities with big companies from around the world that are looking to go somewhere to risk billions of dollars, billions, millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. It's a pretty hefty proposition. You don't want to make a mistake when you're making those kind of decisions, and they're making them right now as we speak. A lot of these companies from outside of our country, what do they look for? What do they look for? Well, this is what I found out. One thing they look for is research universities. We are building a new paradigm. It was best expressed probably by a company called Arthrex that moved in over in Anderson County just recently. The reason they chose Anderson County, they make high precision surgical instruments for orthopedic surgery and all that sort of stuff. Where you used to go in and you'd have your surgery and you'd have to stay there 2 or 3 days and then have rehabilitation for weeks after that. Now you walk out the same day or the next day with a Band-Aid on. That's it. That's because of this sophisticated instruments that they make. They started in Minnesota, moved to Florida, and just recently decided to open up in Anderson County. Why did they do that? What do we have here that they don't have in those other places? One thing, we got good wealth. And that makes a big difference. A lot of people in the Rust Belt, they're tired of it. They find it with the advent of telephones and air conditioning and ease of travel and all that, they know there is another life somewhere else, and they're tired of shoveling soon, and they want to come someplace that's better. Of course, we got a lot of sunshine. But Arthrex, the CEO said, they looked around, and they discovered in South Carolina they can have a collaborative relationship with a research university, Clemson. And there are a lot of very exciting things going on at these three. We have three research universities, USC, Clemson, and MUSC. It's off the scale, some of the things they do. And you have to read and you don't hear about it usually about what they're doing. But I mean, it's space age, high tech, sophisticated thing. So we said, we have that relationship with Clemson. And also, Anderson University is here. They have about 3,500 students, I think most of which are going into nursing. Perfect for their kind of work. And also, they had a great technical college there as well. So those three things, a source of this technical expertise to build that workforce, to work in that plant, to work on the robots that they have, to do all the other things that they have. And by the way, in these big plants like BMW and Michelin and those others, nobody carries toolboxes anymore. They have laptop computers. It looks like a hospital. This is clean as a hospital in these big plants. And they pay a lot of money. But that's the new paradigm that we have in South Carolina. We're able to do that. They can't do it in other places. In South Carolina alone, in the United States, if you're in some other country and you're looking to go somewhere, you want to expand. And this is the biggest market in the whole world, so that's why they want to come here so they can sell here. If you're looking to come here, what will South Carolina do? You come over to our technical college infrastructure, which has a component called ReadySC, and we will put together a team. We got 16 technical colleges. It started in 1961. We're way ahead of everybody else. And we will send a group of people to your company in China or Switzerland or wherever you are, and we will examine your factory. We'll examine how your people work, the culture, the attitudes, all that, and come back to South Carolina and devise a curriculum in a technical college in order to build the kind of training, the kind of people that you need to work in your plant. Nobody else in the United States does that. It doesn't cost a dime. If that company is willing to come, come here and make a major investment, we'll do that, Paul. Nobody else can do that. We have a right-to-work law and a right-to-work attitude. We have the lowest union participation in the United States, 1.9% or something like that. It's very low. What else we have with those technical colleges? We also have a great port. The Port of Charleston is a great, great port. It's a natural port. It's a harbor. It's not like Savannah. Savannah's on a river. That's different. Okay, it's not as wide. It's not as deep. The advantage that Savannah, the Port of Savannah, has over South Carolina is they have a lot of land. They have a lot of space. And so they can build storage facilities. So a lot of these companies want to store things there, bring them in and store them, and pick them up in the need. And by the way, I probably shouldn't say the name of the company, but I found out when I was on the Ports Authority, Nikki had appointed me that for 4 years. There are some of these meats that come in might stay down there for 2 years before they finally get to a store somewhere. They freeze them up real good. I said 2 years. Isn't that something? And we don't have all that. We don't have that storage capacity. But what we do have is our harbor is deep and it's getting deeper. It's deep and it's getting deeper. I worked recently with Lindsey Graham. The Corps of Engineers was putting out their budget, and they did not have any line in it for deepening the harbor. Our legislature, 3 years ago, wisely put up $300 million to deepen the harbor in case the federal government was not willing to go along. And so we had that money there, but we still needed to have more, and it needed to be in the Corps of Engineers budget. Well, I was working with the people in the White House administration, and Lindsey was working with the Congress and also was calling the Secretary of the Army and everyone else he knew, saying that this money has got to be in that budget. Well, they put some money in the budget, just a few million, but what that means, we'll be able to expand that. So last month, we started on the dredging in Charleston Harbor. It'll be 55 feet deep. Now, what does that mean? That means that at low tide, 24 hours a day, the biggest ships in the world will be able to get in and out of the Charleston Harbor. You can have two at a time, one going in, coming out. You can only have one in Savannah, for example, and it's not that deep. They won't be able to do that. There's no way to make it that deep. But also, in addition to that, we have something else that nobody else in the country has. Besides having that harbor, we've got two inland ports. We have a port in Greer, as you know. Y'all probably seen it. I saw it for the first time not long ago after I came up for when they opened it up. And it was just land with concrete slabs and then putting up the buildings. But you go by there now and you see those cranes and all those containment units stacked up. It looks like a Port of Charleston. Well, that's a 400-mile savings for anybody coming in on 95. They can drop their load there. It can be picked up by our Southern Gulf of Southern and carried to Charleston. Same thing in reverse. That saves time, saves money, saves a 400-mile trip. And just a few months ago, we broke ground in Dillon County for an inland port on CSX, that is the rail line, as we go up across I-95, this one crosses 85. Nobody else in the country has got that. So when these companies come in and they're looking at us, and they're looking at these assets, they look at what nature's given us and what we've built, there's nobody that can compare. So that's why they're coming here. But the main thing they told me, and I was delighted to hear, that I've suspected, as you have, they said it's the people. It is the people of South Carolina. How did we get the way we are? It may be that history that I referred to. I don't know how it is that we've gotten to the way we are. But the chairman of BMW on the expansion, the 25th anniversary, said, and keep in mind, BMW, that's their biggest plant in the world, where they produce a brand new BMW every 61.7 seconds. That's right, every 61.7 seconds, a new BMW rolls off the line. And they're expanding, so it's going to be even more than that. He said, and I quote, South Carolina is a different place, different from any place in the United States. It is a handshake state. So what I mean by that is when somebody in South Carolina gives you their word, they will keep it. And I've heard that from these other executives. It's interesting what from people from somewhere else, when they come in and they look at us, these are the things they say. So we really do have something to sell if we don't mess it up. We have these assets that are put together. We got the people that want to work. But one of the main obstacles we have to go through is an attitudinal one. It's a cultural one where everybody in this room was probably brought up thinking that if you don't get a 4-year degree from college, four-year degree in some sense, that we got a lot of people getting history degrees and other degrees that are marketable out there at all. And they got that degree, but it's hard to say that they're successful in terms of employment. So what's the answer to that? Right now, we in these big plants and other businesses around our state, we have got 60,000 people that are looking for jobs. 60,000 jobs looking for people to go in. And in these plants, we have need for air conditioning, for all sorts of engineers, for all kinds of mechanics, brick masons, truck drivers, all those sorts of those skills are getting more and more sophisticated. But a welder can start off with $75,000 a year after a two-year college degree from a technical college. And you got one of the best ones in the whole world right here in Greenwood with Dr. Miller. That's in, he and I have been discussing things about how we can even improve the performance of that. But we've got all of that here. We need to break through the cultural barrier to where parents generally think that their child must have a four-year degree instead of that two-year associate's degree. And there are jobs out there, and they're more and more coming all the time. But there's a lot of fighting going on. Samsung, as you know, just a few months moved into UPAC. They plan on keeping on coming, too. And they have relationships, they're entering into collaborative relationships with memos of understanding with Clemson and USC. And at USC, by the way, IBM has their national data analytics headquarters there. Also, Siemens gave them a gift of $460-something million, I believe that's, maybe it's more than that, of their top-of-the-line engineering software. They have all sorts of combinations and collaborations going on, high-tech brain power things, and those are the things that are going to take us to the top. So what do we need to do? We need to be sure that we don't mess up the progress that we've made, and we need to be sure to accelerate what we're doing. And one way we have to do that, the rising tide that lifts all ships, of course, is this economic development and expansion. When people have jobs, a lot of problems go away. I've seen it myself as U.S. Attorney and also in the Attorney General's office. Domestic violence goes down when people are working. Drug use is going, we got an opioid crisis, that's another thing that will. Drug usage goes down, domestic violence, marriages go up, divorces go down. Everything gets better when people have work, they have good jobs, they have choices. And I heard from a fellow the other day, had a two-year associate's degree down in the low country, and he's trying to decide whether to keep working for Mercedes or go to Volvo. Now that's the kind of choice if you like that. But ladies and gents, we've got to wake up in education. That's one other thing. The environment is another issue. But we have to wake up in education because we've got to educate the children. And we've been toying, we've been making fixes here and there, but I think we need to have a revolution in our educational thinking. You may have heard, I've been touring some of the districts that are having trouble. A lot of them are making progress. We got some of the greatest schools in the whole country. And by the way, they're having apprenticeship programs. They're marrying and collaborating with these factories and plants and with the technical colleges and with the high schools and making that a seamless transition into those jobs. So we can do that. They can't do that in other places. But if we don't educate the young children all the way through high school, if we don't get that done, then this bubble's going to pop sometimes because there's just not going to be enough people that can handle these kind of jobs. So I have figured out, and maybe you have as well, I understand what it takes to have a great educational system, and that is number one, to eliminate poverty, and number two, have only the greatest teachers. That's what we have to do. Well, how do you eliminate poverty? Well, that takes us back to the economic development that I've referred to. And because a lot of times economic development is slow, there's a lot that we're going to have to do to help boost people up. How do you get the best teachers? Well, we have to pay them, but we have to convince them that they can go to these rural areas and teach there. That's where we really do need to help. Also, the health questions that confront people in the rural areas where they don't have hospitals, they don't have doctors, they don't have nurses, how do you do that? How do you keep those people, give them avenues to use in order to stay healthy? We got to take it to them. They can't take a day off to go to the doctor. Don't have somebody to take care of the children. We have to take it to them. That's That's where telemedicine comes in. MUSC's got a great program. We got an ETV network here that's second to none in the United States. Now, all these collaborations that we can make, and if y'all have seen the little doc-in-a-box things that they have, even in some of the drugstores now, I think CVS has a minute clinic. All those ideas are great ideas, but we have to make it available for the people to stay healthy. Final point I mentioned, I know we're running out of time, is the environment. We have to have a clean, safe environment. And by safe, I mean we have to have strong law enforcement. And we are lucky in South Carolina to have very good law officers. What we do not have is something that they do not have anywhere else, and that is a quick communication and collaboration among all of those different officers so that they can respond instantly and with each other. If you can't talk to the other people, then there's no way that you can coordinate. And recently we signed up with what we call the FirstNet program. It's an emergency network that combines all of those people together on a single network so they can speak to each other right now without worrying about getting a block out. As you, when you go to a football game and you try to use your cell phone, you can't get through. That won't happen with this new network that we're creating right now. But we have to keep the place clean. I remember when the Reed River was on fire one time. Y'all probably know that too. Well, it hadn't burned in a long time. That's all the trash is out of it. There's no better example of how South Carolina is on the way up than right here in the city of Greene. There's not a better example. It is based on leadership. It's based on thorough thought. It's based on a lot of hard work by a whole lot of people. But again, having seen this place when it was a child, when it was a beautiful place, having seen it go into a slump and looking at it now, I mean, this is a destination. I think Charleston's the number one destination according to one of those magazines, and Greenville's the number two destination in the United States. Well, what do you expect? Of course, this is South Carolina. But then we are on the way up, and what we have to do is be sure we don't tax the people too much. I won't get into it in length unless you ask me to. That's why I vetoed that gas tax. You cannot tax your way into prosperity. We need not need to have that money come be put on the gas tax. There was enough money coming in on the gas tax at the time. If we just spent it all on the roads, we wouldn't have had a single problem. That's why I opposed it. It passed over my veto. I'm opposed to raising taxes. I've read the books. I've talked to Arthur Laffer. We had him at the mansion not long ago. I remember Ronald Reagan, John Kennedy, lowering taxes and all everything going up. But because it passed, what I intend to do now is to be sure that the Highway Commission and the Highway Department prioritizes the roads and spends the money only on the roads that fit those priorities. If we do that, we'll do fine. But if you read Arthur Laffer's book, final point, read his book, you will see, as you instinctively know, that when the states that raise the taxes on the people are the ones that are not growing. Some states don't have a state income tax. They do it on the sales tax. Those that have low taxes are lowering them. They are the ones taking off. It's just like night follows day. It's as simple, and that's why I am opposed to regulations and taxes that strangle the economic development of this county, this state, this city, and this country. So that's my story. It's a famous football player from the University of South Carolina, Alex Hawkins, once said, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And I'll be glad to answer your questions. And thank you for inviting me.
Improvement in the state. As you probably know, South programs do you have in mind to improve public education, and where is the money coming from?
Yeah, that's a great question. I will promise you this, there will never be enough money in any government, including the state government, county government, city or federal government, or any other place that's got any money to do everything that we need to do or we want to do. There'll never be enough. We got our 6 foot bed and about a 4 foot blanket, and we can't stretch it that far. So we're gonna have to prioritize some things. And I think we can look around and all see some things that are not necessarily priorities when compared to, say, education. So in public education, I mentioned very broadly, we have to eliminate poverty. We can't take all the children and raise them up. There's no way to have the money to do that. But the home life of some of the children just is not one that is conducive to learning. Excuse me. So in those instances, we're gonna have to have some programs that we've begun, and we need to continue. We need to emphasize the economic growth. That's a slower process, but it is a guaranteed process. But the big answer is good principals and good teachers. And right now is we have good principals, we have good teachers, but we have some that are not as good that need not to be in teaching in the public school or in the public school system. We have to recognize, just like every other type of job, that some you have to have the best people if you're going to make progress. And it's very difficult if you have a small school district and you have a school board of a number of people and a superintendent and the principals and the teachers and everybody, they're all friends and cousins who live in the same community. It's very difficult to make the kind of decisions to remove people who are not performing up to the level that needs to be done. So we're going to have to find a way to do that. I've talked to people all over the place. Some of the people that are deep in educational understanding have suggested we need an impartial board to make those kind of tough decisions to let somebody, remove somebody so you can get a better teacher. At some point, if you have a good principal and a good teacher, you're gonna have success. It provided that the children that come in have the capability. The question is they haven't had the environment to get them up to really be ready to learn. But if you got good teachers and good principals, you can make miracles. In Chapin High School, just outside of Columbia, we just got the Akeem Ross, who's 39 years old, I think, was the National Principal of the Year. It's the third year in about 12 years in South Carolina has had that award. So we have to understand there are some school districts that need to be combined, because each district has got their own staff, it's got their own bureaucracy, the administration. And there's one, we have one that's got 686 students in the whole district and got a several number board. Well, they ought to be joined up with the district next door. You don't need to close down the school, you just need to let one board, let that one administration run all of the schools and not have that separate. But also charter schools, I've been working with the charter school system. I see some defects in the way that's done. We can make it better, we can have more of them. Private schools don't need much help, they're doing their thing. But also magnet schools, there's a lot of school choice ideas that we need to implement. The Commission on Higher Education, I think I've had some constructive conversations with that group. I used to go, Governor Campbell appointed me to that years ago, and I got an insider's view of that at that time. But there are a lot of things we can tighten up and tune up and make work better. But the essential thing is we've got to have good teachers and good principals. Without that, no amount of fixing is going to work. No amount. If you have the number one rule, I think there are a lot of business people in here. If you have good people, you don't need a whole lot of rules. You just need the basics. You don't need a whole lot of rules. You don't need a whole lot of testing. You don't need a whole lot of watching. But if you got poor people, people that are not doing the job or don't want to do the job or not able to do it anymore, no amount of rules are going to work. I hope that answers the question. But if we don't educate the children, we're not going to continue on this rise that we're experiencing right now. Yes, sir?
Yeah, regarding economic development,
maybe they are, but I know, for example, this is one anecdote with BMW. I remember there were people protesting the, there's some protesters outside, by the way, I still wonder who they protest. there were a bunch of fellas out there with sledgehammers banging up a BMW just before the BMW plant got here. But that turned out to be, I think, a good idea. Actually, that really set the pace for a lot of others. But some other big things that we have to do. This MOX facility down in Aiken, or I've been working with the administration. We need to keep that going. We got to open up Yucca. Y'all know where Yucca Mountain is? That's where all this waste that can't go in. You know, it's close. When I was attorney general, brought the lawsuit that resulted in a victory that said that the D.C. Court of Appeals said they must open Yucca. The government must open Yucca. But of course, if they're not given the money to do it, then they can't do it. But the Obama administration had decided to close up Yucca. They told the Department of Energy to withdraw the application from the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to open Yucca. So we brought the lawsuit, we in Aiken County. We won the lawsuit. The judge said, you can't do that. It's the law. You must open Yucca. But they can't do it if they don't have the money. So we're getting money from the Trump administration to move forward. But down in Aiken, at the Savannah Rubber Center site, by law, we have plutonium, weapons-grade plutonium coming in. And how do you get rid of weapons-grade plutonium pursuant to the treaty that we entered into with the Russians and others? Well, you have to put it through this mixed oxide procedure that separates it into uranium pellets that can be used in reactors for very low price for all the nuclear industry, and then waste that can be handled in a place like Yucca. That's how you get rid of it, or you blow it up. Those are the two ways. There's no place else in the country where we can put that plutonium except for in Yucca. So we got to open that up right now. We got it down and we have it still coming in Italy. So we're working on that as well. Those are the kind of big things that can make a difference in how we move forward on this great trajectory that we have now. But it's economic development.